Hi everybody, welcome. This is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical. We're doing a webinar on multiple sclerosis. First slide talks about multiple scars, which is really what we're talking about, sclerosis. And it involves damage at the in the final analysis to these insulation coatings. So here's an oligodendrocyte that means oligofused dendrocyte, meaning branches. And what it does is it coats these axons, which are not just figurative but literally electrical wires. So this is the insulation that allows the conduction of nerves across vast relative distances. So it's mainly made of this fatty substance, this myelin sheath. And so this is what we need to conduct electrical impulses. You've heard of gray matter. Gray matter is the stuff that's on the outside. That's the neurons, the body of the nerves. And white matter is the cabling, the nerve tracks that goes to where it's going, whether it be in the eyes or in the cranial nerves, body, sensation, movement, and also control of visceral function. So this is why when you mess up the insulation, you can mess up all aspects of our experience and function. Because of that, it's a very protean disease. This is Proteus, the god of the sea, and he was able to assume many different forms. And protein is never a good thing in medicine because it's hard to diagnose at times. In addition, disease can be intermittent, meaning it comes and goes, remitting, it gets better and comes back, as well as relapsing. These are kind of similar terms, although slightly different. The muscles can have spasms, involuntary movement, tremor, and weakness or difficulty doing intentional movement. So they're affected in all manner of presentation. Sensations, what we call the afferent, meaning it's going to the central nervous system or control center. This is messed up too, so you can get facial pain, paresthesias. Also under neural control centrally is bowel and bladder function, the ability to hold urine and feces, and the ability to, at appropriate times, expel them is controlled by mainly sympathetic and parasympathetic, which are sort of like the HVAC system of the body. So you run into dysfunction with this commonly. Visual problems are not uncommon. Some of them related to optic neuritis, which is inflammation of the optic nerve. So you can get double vision or diplopia. You can get problems with the eyes moving in different directions or unintentional movements of the eyes, known as nystagmus. Problems with visual acuity and discomfort or pain. Speech-wise, you can have problems with slurring. It can be problems chewing, and they can have telegraphic speech, which is sort of like instead of I'm going to the store, it'd be me go store, that kind of thing. Crude and fragmented speech. Of course, the brain is our central organ for thinking, so we have problems with attention, memory, judgment. And then overall mood is affected with depression, fatigue, dizziness, and also postural and balance issues can be affected as well. The epidemiology of this disease is interesting. It appears to be autoimmune of some kind, and we'll get into what that means. Women are affected more than men, and this is not necessarily a classical aging disease like some of the other ones, PMR, macular degeneration. We've done webinars on those topics. This is an early onset. In fact, you can even have it in childhood. It appears to be, once you have it, triggered by stress. Sun exposure, fevers, hot deaths, all these things are kind of stressors. So here's a typical progressive relapsing MS course. As we get older, maybe you have times when there really isn't that much symptomatology and it flares, and there are times of stress, and that's something Karen will talk about as well. Different patterns, but in general, MS is not considered a curable condition, but one that gets progressively worse with bouts of flares. There's an interesting geographic and ethnic predilection, more common in the higher latitudes away from the equator, which may be a weather-related phenomenon. It's not an inherited disease, say like colorblindness or Huntington's disease because the monozygotic identical twin concordance is only 25%. So your normal chance of getting MS is about 1 in 750. If you have a first-degree relative, a sibling or parent with it, it's 1 in 40. And if you have an identical twin, it's only 1 in 4. So it's not 100% concordant, meaning there's probably not only a epigenetic component, but most likely a genetic component. So something about the regulation of the immune system seems to be predisposing this. They might have different expression of epitopes or antigens on their myelin sheaths or God knows who or why this happens, but it's not a purely genetic disease. One thing that people have looked at, they've looked at many different viral triggers, and one that comes pretty high on the list of suspects would be the Epstein-Barr virus, or the so-called chronic fatigue or kissing disease virus mononucleosis, which is the subject of a future webinar, the herpes viridae, which we'll talk about in the future. The diagnosis of MS is really one of, like Lyme disease, you need to have a high index of suspicion, and a lot of times clinicians maybe, if they're presenting at the primary care level, wouldn't be thinking of this right off the bat in a young, healthy woman, although they should. And in the past, we were trained to do things like spinal tap and look for a bunch of protein in these clonal bands. They're just breakdown products of the inflammation going on in the nervous system, and also evoke potentials, both sensory, visual, or also sound, and to look for conduction abnormalities, input and then response. But this stuff is all archaic now. Really, the MR is the gold standard with over 90% sensitivity. So clinically, if you don't have an MR, you can still resort on clinical signs and neurological exam, including reflexes, movement, figuring out where the sensation is weak, and doing a cranial nerve exam. The eyes can have difficulty with field defects and movement, as well as potentially anisocoria or asymmetric eyes and things like that. Oh, this interesting picture is a zoom in next to the ventricles. So if we talked about the gray matter being the neurons on the outside, this does your thinking, and the white matter is the nerve tracks, the cords going out. There's a cushion here. It's the ventricles. This is the fluid-filled area, and it's from this area adjacent to it that the neurogenesis occurs. So nerves are created here, and they need to migrate to the cortex along with the oligodendrocytes, which coat the newly formed nerve tracts. So the old saw that we don't make new brain cells, so be careful how hard you party is not true. We do make new brain cells. In fact, estimated perhaps 10,000 a night. So that's the upshot of what you're doing when you're dreaming, I believe, is that you're repurposing and adding semantic significance to the things that happened in the day and forming new memories and emotions, which are very similar and synergistic. Anyway, you do make brain cells. It happens when you dream, and this is an ongoing remodeling. The treatment for MS, I phrase this rhetorically, is it better than nothing? Sadly, you know, we have so much confidence in the medical establishment that placebo controls are rarely done, so that we do standard of care. As you saw in the brain cancer webinar, the standard of care is quite inadequate. So the fact that people are doing randomized control trials with things that don't work shouldn't be questioned as suspect by institutional review boards. But that's we have a faith anyway, a trust. So the first thing is interferons beta 1A or Avonex is a supposedly anti-inflammatory immune modulator. Interferons are immune cytokines. The second would be glatiramer or copaxone. This is a polymer of some amino acids, glutamic acid, lysine, alanine, tyrosine, so that's why it's glutiramer. Some clever person thought, hey, if the immune system is attacking the myelin, let's form amino acid sequence similar to the myelin basic protein, and we can distract the immune system. I guess that's okay thinking, but unfortunately the randomized controlled trials and the Cochrane Review meta-analyses don't show that this is at all helpful. On the other spectrum of not being helpful but harmful is mitoxantrone, or novantrone, which is a topoisomerase inhibitor. Topoisomerase is a enzyme which is responsible for cleaving and handling the winding and unwinding of the DNA, and it's critical. So again, you're interrupting a critical step globally. It's not like it's targeted just for the affected MS stem cells or cells. So this is tantamount to chemotherapy. It's really a way of inhibiting or destroying or damaging DNA, which is probably on the face of it never a good idea. Natalizumab or Tysabri, AB usually is an antibody. So it's a monoclonal antibody versus the cell adhesion molecule alpha-4 integrin. What the heck does that mean? Well, this is a cell surface protein, I believe, which allows immune cells to migrate across vessels. So what happens is the cell is being recruited to an area of inflammation, the immune cell, and it has to squeeze through the potential cracks in the capillaries to get out to help out. So this inhibits that by, I suppose, coating these cell adhesion molecules. So I think that there might be some issues with that. One of the issues was PML, or progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, which means you're destroying the white matter. So that stands to reason. If you have antibodies against the white matter, against the cell adhesion molecule, there might be a problem. So potential danger, chemotherapy, not proven to be effective, and globally anti-inflammatory. The last is Galenia or fingolimod, and this again is impeding your normal immune system migration to the central nervous system, which would be lumped in with the methotrexate, azathioprine, IVIG, cytoxin, steroids. These would be ways of impeding your immune system, with the thought being that the problem is one of the immune system, not of what's going on in the body or in that area to kill the cells and clear the damaged cells. So we might be looking more at the smoke rather than the fire. And of course, management of symptomatic treatment of symptoms is important with things. Some people have overactive bladder, bowel, the mood is often depressed, and amantadine can also be given for fatigue. There are several ways to think of disease. This is just one I came up with last night. I guess you could think of disease as being a toxic or metabolic phenomenon. This would be like poison ice cubes. I mean, there's only so many poison ice cubes you could take. I mean, of course, heavy metals and things will accumulate in the liver, and that's not good. But let's say you get poisoned by hemlock, or you have a metabolic derangement like a scurvy or rickets. These can be fixed easily and washed out, and the liver and kidney are good at detoxifying. Second kind of disease would be an infectious disease. This would be like literally skating on thin ice. Usually we do okay. Sometimes we fall through the ice, and but usually it's a temporal phenomenon. It's something that we can take care of, although there are chronic infections like we talked about with Lyme disease webinar. Most diseases fall into the category of genetic, and this is a total cop-out, but basically what I'm saying is you can have inborn diseases such as Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. You can have a loss of heterozygosity, which means you got two copies of a gene, let's say it's the telomerase RNA gene, and you lose one of them throughout the course of a lifetime. Well, if you're born with one functioning telomerase RNA gene, that's called dyskeratosis congenita, and you die of old age at 11. If during the course of the phylogeny or the life of that little life of anyone, we lose both copies of telomerase, then we're in deep trouble with that one stem cell. But there's so many backups, it doesn't matter. But this holds true for everything. This is inborn errors with bad genes. One copy of good gene is a type of genetic disease. And then there's the mishmash of all the other diseases, high blood pressure, diabetes, Alzheimer's, which is just acquired DNA errors. And so we've argued many times in these webinars that the copying of the DNA, the replication, in essence, allows for the uncapping. And then the the accumulation of errors in the stem cells. So it's errors in the DNA, also in the epigenetic signals or switches or the software in the DNA, and even mitochondrial errors can accumulate. So basically there's toxic, infectious, and then there's genetic diseases, which is all the rest. Why is that like an iceberg or Godzilla? It's because this is something that's self-perpetuating. It's a monster. It's big. It's not going away easily. So because diseases that are stem cell are potentially immortal, they lead to big problems for us as we get older. And this would include all the cancers, of course. Autoimmune is a fourth category. And this if you look at this mishmash of insects, maybe this could be flies, maggots, or ants, or termites. It really doesn't matter. What we're talking about here is that the immune system is meant to regulate cell death, cell murder, cell suicide, cell clearance. So the cells are in constant crosstalk with each other. And undoubtedly, MS is a condition which is, although genetically predisposed and infectiously triggered, resulting in a toxic condition to the myelin, it's basically a stem cell disease that's autoimmune in nature. So something about Epstein-Barr allows the system to start attacking itself, primarily in the oligodendrocytes. So there's some kind of dysregulation, and then inflammation, and that stuff happens. So let's go through some literature, which is quite interesting. This is out of 2010, Journal of Experimental Neurology. And what they found was that remyelination in multiple sclerosis is not because of a failure of stem cells, but that it's a failure of differentiation rather than recruitment. So it's like the signs from the Great Depression, jobless men keep going. We can't take care of our own. When you go to a stem cell treatment, maybe they do an autologous, they take out stem cells, they expand them clonally, and they put them back in your body in Germany or Venezuela or whatever, Mexico. People ask me, should I do stem cell treatment? I say, I don't really believe in it, because the problem is not the candidate stem cells. Usually most people are awash in candidate stem cells. There's no jobs. So what that means is, in whatever given organs we're talking about, knee joints, heart, brain, there's still those queen bees we talk about in podcast 5. The queen bees are like master stem cell copies, and they're pumping out copies of themselves that are defective. But she's unable to kill herself, so she's taken up that job. And so it's not like you need more stem cells. You need that queen bee to get killed. So that's why I say don't get the stem cell treatments, because it's really, you need a way to get rid of those damaged stem cell niches and dysfunctional queen bees. But they jumped to the conclusion and said, if we have a pharmacological way to help these cells differentiate, then maybe we'll be in good shape. But again, I think they're looking at it backwards, because 5 years ago, some Japanese scientists were able to make pluripotent stem cells and make regular run-of-the-mill cells stem-like. But that might not be the way to go, because we're already talking about damaged cells. Why try and make those better if we can just kill them off and be replaced by newer itinerant stem cells? So that's my conclusion. Why fix the broken ones? In this case, the stem cells in this model of MS are only fulfilling one half of their stemness quality. Now, stemness, what is a stem cell? Stem cell is immortal, for all intents and purposes, or highly proliferative, and that's strictly a function of telomerase activity. In order to make infinite copies, you need to have an infinite way to relengthen the ends of your telomeres, because as we know from other webinars, cells that copy will shorten and die off after 50 divisions. The other important quality of stemness is asymmetric division. So what does that mean? Asymmetric division means you make a copy of yourself and you make a more differentiated copy. So it's like this master copy which, if it differentiated into two daughters, it wouldn't be a stem cell. It has to differentiate into another master copy and then a more differentiated useful cell. So in this case, we'd be talking about an oligodendrocyte progenitor cell. It's just one step removed or one step higher in the Stratego analysis. It has more potential to be other things. So these stem cells have lost that quality of stemness. They aren't making a functional oligodendrocyte. they're maybe making two bad stem cell copies instead of one master copy and one differentiated oligodendrocyte. So, great epiphany there. Here's a study out of Beth Israel, where I did my residency training in Harvard Medical School, and they looked at one of these hormones or cytokines called neuregulin, which is one of several semaphores, or I'm not sure what they call it, but they're signalers. And this brings out the point that neuregulin is necessary for the normal development of oligodendrocytes, and the absence in these genetically null or engineered to not produce organisms contributed to the lack of myelin. But again, maybe not the greatest clue in figuring out how to prevent or treat MS, because all we're saying is that at the scene of the crime, there's not enough neuroregulin. Well, that's one of the things produced by healthy interaction between neurons and glial cells and whatever else, the matrix. So that's really probably not where the rubber meets the road. Getting a little more intriguing would be this study from the University of Melbourne, where they looked at, transcription and post-transcriptional control of CNS myelination. So they found that this area lining the ventricle, remember we talked about the fact that the highly proliferative, infinitely reproducing neural stem cells line the ventricles, and that's where your dreams and memory come from. Well, it turns out that that's also where the oligodendrocyte progenitor cells come from, are the ones that are going to make the myelin coating cells. So they have to migrate away from the ventricle and coat the whole line, the whole axon. And they run up and down the rails, if you were, up and down the phone lines, insulating them. And what they found these arise from the subventricular zone and they migrate out. And then they differentiate into more mature oligodendrocytes. So the reason I brought up podcast 9 is because the most universal symptom of taking a TA65 before sleep would be improvement in sleep. And I argue that this is because your cells are copying at such a high efficiency that the dreaming, the refragmenting or defragmenting of the memory and the psyche is much more efficient. So I would say 9 out of 10 people notice a qualitative difference in their sleep quality, and I think it's because of the rapid and efficient copying of these neural stem cells. So if that's good for memory in TA, maybe it's good for these oligodendrocyte progenitor cells, and maybe it's helping them recoat or reheal along these white matter tracks. Who knows? OPC is as opposed to an oligodendrocyte, which is a fully differentiated, this is my job in life type of cell. An OPC is a semi-stem and semi-differentiated, so it's taken one step towards differentiation. It's not going to be like the neural progenitor cell. It could be a neuron, astrocyte, glial cell, oligodendrocyte. No, it's already committed to the oligodendrocyte line. So slightly differentiated, less proliferative. I love this picture of amoebas migrating. This is a chemotaxis, or moving towards chemicals, I guess you could say. But the reason I like it is because, let's say this is the ventricle, and these guys are going the wrong way, but let's say you're an oligodendrocyte progenitor cell, and you have to migrate out and myelinate the tracks. This is really what we're talking about in terms of dysfunction. So that's why typically you see on the MRI, the findings are radial. They radiate perpendicular out from the ventricles, because this is the pathway that the journey on which these guys get killed. So it'll be going on its little Oregon Trail march out, and then, boom, you'll see a white plaque, and it orients like this, perpendicular to the site of origin. So there's this scorched earth here where it just doesn't get passed or doesn't coat, and that's why they have that typical appearance on MRI. If you go back to podcast 5, we introduced the concept of mesenchymal stem cells, which is kind of a misnomer, because mesenchymal implies more of like a mesodermic or a connective tissue, bone, fat, this kind of thing. Turns out that probably the better term would be multipotent adult progenitor cells instead of mesenchymal stem cells, although we'll always call it that. just like we'll always call Native Americans Indians, even though they're really Native Americans. It's just the name got stuck that way. But the point of this being validated in all other studies is that mesenchymal cells can also differentiate into endoderm, that's the inside layer, with like liver, intestinal, and also ectoderm, skin, and the nerve cells. So it's a misnomer. It's not just for mesenchymal. But anyway, the mesenchymal stem cells we talked about being, they're like itinerant stem cells. They're queen bees roaming the body, the mind, everywhere, looking for job vacancies. And if they find them, they will differentiate according to what's needed in that milieu. Let's see, out of Florida, they concluded that the mesenchymal stem cells can be primed towards becoming neurons, even conducting nerve potentials and things, just by the antigens in that milieu. So basically, that's something we talked about and is being validated by this study or this review. So you don't just have to have brain cells from the neural progenitor cells. It appears that the mesenchymal stem cells that we talked about in the back pain webinar, the bone health webinar, all these other webinars, these things are amoebas crawling all over our organism and looking for job vacancies and damaged niches. People are getting excited about mesenchymal stem cells, so they use this in an animal model. The animal model typically is called experimental allergic encephalomyelitis, and they introduce like a very similar reaction in the mice. And so what they found, they could take human mesenchymal stem cells and put them into the mice, and it would blunt or prevent this development of this experimental MS. And it showed increased oligodendrocyte production. I guess the xenograft or didn't really matter. They were still differentiated and not rejected by the host. So you had better coding of the axons and decreased T-cell immune response. So it blunted whatever crazy inflammation and destruction that was going on as well. Another study in the exact same mold would be this study out of the Multiple Sclerosis Research Center in New York, where they used mesenchymal stem cells. Again, slightly more differentiated along the neural line, neural progenitor, but still very stem-like, meaning highly telomerase active and replicative ad infinitum, and then also with a slight differentiation towards neuroprogenitor as opposed to being, you know, kidney or liver or bone marrow or what have you. Anyway, what they found in their EAE model, the mice model again, is that if you gave this, it would help prevent the development of MS. And interesting, because a single injection didn't help, but you need to have multiple injections. So that may be like the signage here by the Dust Bowl. It's not just you go there one time. You got to keep on going by and by until that job opening opens up. So multiple stem cell injections appear to help in this experimental model. This is the last literature study, and it's coming out of 2011 in Italy. And what they looked at was, again, EAE, experimentally induced autoimmune encephalitis in mice. And they looked at the oligodendrocyte precursors, and they kind of just looked at the lay of the land, and they said that, okay, in the first 20 days, there's a lot. The place is bathing with recruited stem-like oligodendrocyte progenitors. By day 39, perhaps there was a window that was closed, and the environment was not as hospitable to having adequate mature oligodendrocytes. So there may be a strike where when the iron is hot, a phenomenon going on here, where there's the insult, let's say, from an Epstein-Barr flare and T-cell attacking of these myelin sheaths or oligodendrocytes, and you got the first 2-3 weeks to really adequately scorch and burn and then replant the area. And something in that process might be incomplete clearing, inefficient clearing, because of a failure of mesenchymal stem cells or failure of the efficiency of clearing, and then inadequate replanting, or the new oligodendrocytes, or maybe these little green shoots are not what they should be or could be. And so in that sense, there might be an aging component involved, as the mesenchymal stem cells and the oligodendrocytes, they still follow the principle that they can only be as good as their last stem cell originator, and is only as old or young as that as well. So, okay, if anyone's still awake, we're going to do the case, and then we're going to talk to Karen Lerner, who has graciously agreed to speak to us about her condition. Afterwards, we'll do, actually, let's do the raffle now while we're waiting. So, Brenda will go ahead and pick some numbers. I don't think we'll do it live on video, just to save time. Yeah, go ahead and just pick 10. Okay, so Karen is a 49-year-old woman residing in the East Coast with multiple sklerosis, and she's been taking K65 for 4.5 months, at first at 2 capsules nightly, and then now 4. At the age of 39, as she was caring for her mom, who was very ill, she had a flare of optic neuritis and was referred to an ophthalmologist, but at that time they were unable to connect the dots and suggest that it was MS. Over the last decade, she's declared herself to have more symptoms, which are intermittent, meaning at times she's completely asymptomatic with regard to this lesion on the right side. She'll get right-sided numbness, primarily below the waist, but occasionally in the right arm as well, and it's always associated with a weakness, which manifests itself in this particular case as a foot drop. But there are also problems probably with the hip flexors, and definitely the gait and the posture are affected. So she had to, when she was flaring, always lean on a shopping cart when outside and limit her walks, because increased usage of the legs would often bring it on after several hundred feet. The upper extremity would occasionally be involved with handwriting. It would be slow and inefficient. And the predominant feature of her condition was fatigue. And this was persistent even between these flares. The fatigue is described as just being in a fog, a mental fog. And despite this, you know, she was running her business and raising children. And so people would say, well, you probably have chronic fatigue, or oh my gosh, you should be tired. You're your mother too, and you're raising family and business. But nobody really said, oh, you probably have MS. She did notice it got worsened by stress, although not the other cues like temperature or fever. Finally, one of her primary care doctors, a lady, suggested that it could be MS and did an MRI, and the diagnosis was made back in July of 2010. Karen is very thorough in her due diligence, so she went through the options and decided to go with Copaxone, primarily because the others appeared to have bad side effects that she wanted to avoid. And then sometime in December, she was going through the internet and decided that there has to be more of a cellular-based cure, and she got interested in telomerase and got to my website and then decided to order a small trial bottle. She reported, I had the recording, but for some reason my record didn't work, but she describes beautifully how, you know, after about 3 days, already she had felt better in terms of the immediate sleep improvement, but the accumulated mood was improved as well, and the fatigue. And then gradually the episodes were less frequent or not even full-blown, and so the symptoms of numbness and foot drop were going, as well as control of the bladder, has been steadily improving. She did take it and stopped taking it for a week on vacation, and she gradually started feeling back to normal, which was not good at baseline, tired and having these symptoms. So she came back 2 weeks ago and called me and said, oh, I definitely noticed a difference now, so I'm going to go back on. But was happy, I think, in general, that there was something that could take her out and in the right direction, away from disease, because the MS also is very sapping on your spirit when you feel like there is this thing out there that's lurking that can mess you up and is not going to get better or is not curable. So she's very optimistic, I think, of her condition now that she's taken T65 and appears to be a true believer. So let's talk to Karen Lerner. And Karen?
Yeah, I'm here. How are you?
Hi. Good, thanks. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks.
Great. So were you able to listen to most of the presentation?
I was, yes. It was very informative.
Great.
Thank you.
Great. I know it gets kind of like geeky, all the science, but I try and kind of formulate an opinion as to what could be causing this. I could be totally off my rocker because I've only been looking at it for a short time. But did I get your case pretty much right?
Yeah, you did. There was one thing that you mentioned that I had never mentioned to you was when I was 16, I did have mono. And so you said typically most people who have MS did go through that, and I did as a freshman in high school. And I was out of school for about 3 weeks. So I did have that infamous kissing disease. But
did you at least were you playing spin the bottle, or are you still going to that now?
No, I didn't. I don't know what was going
so
on
funny.
With my body, but I did have that as a matter of fact. So
interesting.
But
so that probably laid the groundwork. Yeah.
Yeah, it probably did, and without anybody really knowing what was going on, and I had no idea that this was obviously going to happen to me. And it was small things that were happening over time, and it took a long time for a great physician, my neurologist, to finally come up with the diagnosis. But in my mind, I didn't just want to be on Copaxone. I wanted to find something at the cellular level, and I was listening to television where they mentioned the word telomere, and that's when I went online, and that's when I found you. And it's made a huge difference to me as far as my fatigue, which was the big thing for me, you know, running a business and having kids.
Yeah.
And just the normal daily life has gotten a lot better for me.
That's great. So you mentioned to me that your kids had noticed a difference. Now, how old are they now?
Yeah, 14 and 12, and my daughter in particular, every time, now that I'm home, I sold my business in December, now that I'm home, when she would come in, she'd go, "Mom, how are you? You don't look good." But now that I've been on the T65, I'm going to attribute to that. My personality, I guess, my outlook is better, and she can see it on my face. You know, I'm smiling more, I guess, you know, and so she comments on that.
So it's not I hate my teenage daughter anymore.
No, not at all. Not anymore.
Okay. Perfect. So now tell me about the walking. You say you walk in your backyard, and
I
so how
do.
Is that
I had
changed?
To modify what I do because I used to ride a bike and I used to walk, but I would be away from home and my leg would go to sleep. And it was very difficult and embarrassing to have to drag my leg. So, and then when I was riding my bike, that was very difficult, obviously. So I modified everything by getting a stationary bike within my home, so if my leg does go to sleep, I can get off, obviously. And my husband measured for me around my pool in my backyard the length that I wanted to walk. And so that's what I do on a daily basis. And now when my leg starts going to sleep, I can just walk into my home as opposed to panicking and thinking, how am I going to get home? So, but with this medicine, or, you know, the TA65, what I have noticed is I can walk further and without my leg starting to go to sleep. And I'm going to keep monitoring that, and I want to get up to a further distance, and I'll keep you posted on that.
Great. So it's something that really is not like a intermittent every few months thing. It's persistently always there. There's something wrong with the conduction along that pathway, which can be elicited by overuse, basically.
Yeah,
it's
when
always
I was
there.
Diagnosed, it was severe reoccurring white brain matter disease, which scared me to death, obviously. And then they gave me the medical, you know, multiple sclerosis. The other thing that I had never mentioned to you is heat is a huge thing for me.
Oh, it is heat. Okay.
Oh yeah, heat is huge. I have to have lots of water with me, something cold, especially sitting at my kids' baseball games in August and the East. Yeah, so that's one thing that we'll see if that changes as well. So that's what I'm looking forward to see the changes. I've already seen some great improvements in my daily life because of the TA65, and I hope that
good.
It just keeps improving.
Shows some real improvement in the imaging, too.
Me, too. I can't wait for the doc to say, hey, what are you doing, you know? So.
Yeah. So what was the week like in Florida when you ran out of the day? How could you compare and contrast?
Oh, it was awful. I had not reordered, and I took the last one before I went, and I noticed a difference almost on the second day that I was there, and progressively my stamina was gone. And like you mentioned, when I got back, I immediately called and ordered, and you know, and I've noticed a huge improvement. I'll never let that happen again. But yeah, it was terrible. But I had to stay up. I'm on vacation, spring break with my kids. I couldn't not do what I needed to do. And so I just persevered and pushed through. So
now when people would say, oh, you know, you're working too hard and, you know, you have chronic fatigue and maybe you have this, that, the other thing, well, how would that make you feel? Like, are you depressed? They would attribute to kind of like,
yeah, that was one of the first things that they would say, and that made me feel worse because I knew that there was something going on in my body other than what they were telling me. Are you depressed? Mm. You know, do you need to go on depression medicine and things like that? And it's like, no, I knew that it was something more. And finally, I did get the diagnosis. So
that's good. And well, your symptoms were so focal, I'm surprised they missed it. You're probably not a big complainer then, because a foot drop is a very specific thing, and there's not a heck of a lot that can cause that.
I know. I go to the beach often, and my sandal kept falling off. You know, it was kind of a weird thing to say, hey, why is this happening? But anyway, somebody finally gave it a name, you know, drop foot. So.
And so with you were mentioning, if it's okay to talk about the problem is voiding, so you have to press down sometimes to get completely.
Yeah.
How long has that been a condition?
I have to press on my stomach. The other thing that I had not mentioned to you was prior to being diagnosed, when that was happening to me, I wore a catheter bag for about a month.
Oh my gosh.
And
So the innervation to the bladder was quite insufficient.
Yeah, definitely.
Really,
and now I'm still at 30% when I was tested about 2 months ago.
Post-void residual, yeah.
Yeah.
But you have good control. You're able to hold it, and you're able to expel it with a little manual assistance, a little per day, we call it. Good.
Yes.
So that's improving. So at 49, are you feeling like you're getting younger, or is that too early to say? Or
people say I look like I'm getting younger. I don't know, but...
and did you notice the difference between 2 and 4, Karen? 2 and 4
yeah,
pills?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yep, I do. And I will continue doing it. And like I said, I'm doing the 6-month protocol, and I can't wait to see at the end of 6 months the change. You know, I noticed a drastic improvement, actually, in lots of areas. You know, of the different things that are going on in my life. So I will continue using it.
Good. And so tell me what a typical night of sleep would be before and after starting the TA.
That is the nice thing. It used to be that I could never, you know, I'd fall asleep, then I'd wake up staring at my ceiling, then I'd go back to sleep. Now it's the strangest thing. I have all this energy, but yet I have the best sleep at night. It made no sense to me, the correlation between the two. I thought if I have all this energy, I'm never going to be able to go to sleep. But when I wake up, I am not in a fog. The fatigue is gone. And I have clarity. I have energy. So it's been a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Great. That's great. Well, I'm glad. I can hear it in your voice, and I'm glad that your kids are liking it. And
yeah.
Pretty good. All good.
They like me better, yeah.
Because, you know, ironically, it's usually the menopause and the kids' puberty always coincides, and that ends up being hopefully.
I haven't had any signs of that yet, thank goodness. Not yet.
Good. Did you any other comments on people? If people were asking you, you were kind enough to say you might speak to people if they wanted Thank you. What would be your advice? Could they try it a little bit, or did you notice it right away? I mean, is it that kind of thing, or?
No. That's why I decided to go on the four. I wanted to give it a chance, full strength. You know, I wasn't going to play around anymore. And so that's why I'm doing the four. And I do notice a difference, a huge difference. So I will continue doing that.
Yeah.
And hopefully
but you had the, maybe I misunderstood, but you said that, you know, within 2-3 days, the energy and the mood were starting to improve. And then within two,
oh, yeah,
3 days of coming back from Florida, it started to wane again. So it is,
yeah,
something that can work pretty quickly in some areas. Think.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, immediately. It took, once I got the new shipment, I started, like I said, I started taking the four, and it was almost immediate when I was doing it. When I was only doing the two, at first when I first,
yeah,
started, I was only doing one because I wanted to hold on to the supply. You know, it was like keeping gold.
Yeah.
And then I went to the two. And it took a while for it to work, but with the four, no, it's you know, it's immediate,
yeah,
for me.
Good.
So it only
and
took
but
a day.
There's no withdrawal symptom, right? You don't get like a,
no,
mental withdrawal or addiction or anything like that, right?
Not at all. Not at all. When I my doctor prescribed something for fatigue before, I would get headaches from it, and it was actually a medication that they prescribed to people with narcolepsy, and it was too strong for me. It was not the energy that I needed or wanted. This, the TA65 to me, is, it seems it's all natural. I mean, it's just my energy level that I used to have, you know,
right,
without the feeling that I would get with the other medicine, the Nuvigil.
Yeah.
It was just too much, so.
That's what we're hearing.
Much better.
There's really nothing, there's nothing psychotropic or up or down about taking the TA, which is nice because as an upshot, you don't get any addiction withdrawal or tolerance. Yeah.
Exactly. That's and right. I feel like my old self, you know, myself, my young self, not my old self, but my self that I used to feel like, you know, I don't feel like there's anything wrong. And I love it.
Great.
So
you sold your business, and now you're going to start a new one, right? You just have to be laying around.
Yeah, I have the energy. I'm not afraid now to go ahead and start to have a new endeavor. And so, yes, that's what I'm going to do.
Good. Well,
now I'm going to do something that I'm passionate about and love, and it has to do with sports.
It.
So, yeah.
I love it. I love it. Well, let me open it up to questions. I'm sure somebody wants to ask you a question. Can you hang out for a couple of minutes more?
Certainly.
Okay. Does anybody have a question? Please raise a flag or type into the chat box. We do have a lucky winner on the call. I see. Dr. Thomas France. I think maybe he's not a doctor, but Thomas France, congratulations, sir. You are number two on the list, and you have won a free 30-capsule bottle. Does anybody want to ask Karen a question while we have her? But again, thank you for you know, mentioning, you know, people order on the internet. I don't know who they are, what their stories are, and I'm glad that you shared yours with us because it sounds like you're really getting better day by day.
I am. Thank you so much for doing the research and coming up with the TA65 because I just don't know what I would do without it.
Yeah, you know, and it's funny, I always get in this topic of people getting addicted and a little resentful of it, but it's not like if you don't take it, you feel bad. You just don't feel better, right? You just
don't
start
better.
Getting younger.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I don't feel better.
Yeah.
I'm not addicted to it, but I certainly don't want to go without it because I know it's doing something on my, you know, to me, and
right,
it's helping me.
So you're
hopefully
interesting. You had that, you had that insight that you have to repair the cells, and that's a pretty sophisticated analysis. What was your initial appraisal of the whole drug situation when you did that research and chose?
Well, I watched a program on PBS, and it made sense to me that, you know, it's kind of like, duh, you know, you need to repair the cells. And so when I did my research and I saw this, and I, of course, I thought about it for a long time before I did it. But it just made perfect sense to me that I need to repair the cells, you know. And I didn't want a Band-Aid, even though I'm still doing the Copaxone.
Right.
I'm still doing it, but I needed to do on something on my own. And that's why I decided to do it.
Well, maybe you can shed that as time goes on.
Yeah.
You know, the studies I was surprised. I thought there'd be some improvement, but the randomized controlled trials don't really justify that. But, you know, if you do a Google search, you find that all the paid advertisements are these companies, Galenia, Tisibrine, Aventron, Copaxone, Avonex. So this is a big business. There's a lot of people with this incurable disease. But, again, one man's incurable disease is another man's revenue source. So I think that there's a lot of people taking a lot of medications which don't seem to be doing a lot of good. I don't know.
Yeah. I guess I take it out of fear that, you know, that I'm afraid that it's something that would help. But to be honest, no change whatsoever in the way I was feeling. So,
yeah.
But definitely when I get my next MRI, I'll let you know
I bet you it's going to be. I bet you it's going to be better.
I hope so. The Copaxone, they just say in all the literature that it's just supposed to kind of put me on hold, you know, no more new white brain matter. So it'll be interesting to see if they say, well, you know, you didn't get any new. What are you doing? So I've got that scheduled in 60 days.
Well, it's like the brain cancer webinar. They're like, oh, yeah, we finally cured a brain cancer. You know, so that's fine. You know, success has many mothers, but failure is an orphan, right? So
right.
I'm looking forward to good things. The question here was, are there any papers discussing the use of TA65 for MS? No, but certainly if there's anybody who has the wherewithal, I'm pretty sure that TA scientists will provide placebo-controlled bottles, and we could do a randomized control trial and get that going. And that holds for every one of my 32, soon to be 50, webinar topics. Set up a proposal for a randomized controlled trial, and let's do it. I'm doing one for sleep disorders, hopefully, with the people at MyZio, which is a home sleep monitor. But let's do it. I think that Karen has been the pioneer here, and it's worth looking into, definitely.
Right.
I don't know. So they said, are you having your telomere test measured or your length? Did you do that?
I have not done that. And
no.
I was nervous and scared to do it. you know,
how's it going to change anything, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I was afraid. But, you know, I guess I could go and have that done. Obviously, I need to know what the changes are as well, not just from the MRI in my brain.
We'll send it out to you. If you'd like, we can arrange for that to be even a phlebotomist to come out. But I'm more interested in your brain, see what the MRI shows, because if we can document some good changes there, that would be great.
I know, absolutely. Like I said, 60 days, and I will have my new MRI.
Oh, good.
Yep.
All right, we'll do a little postscript. It'll probably take me 60 days to even edit this webinar, so maybe not. I'm so backed up. I have two in the can already, so.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So your kids are coming home soon. I should let you go.
Yes. I heard one of them just walk in. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thanks for taking the time, Karen. Really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much for doing what you do. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye. Have a great day.
Thanks. So I'm just going to unmute Thomas, although you don't have to say anything. You, Mr. Franz?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, hey, congratulations. You won a bottle.
Yes, I understand that.
Did you know you were going to win a bottle, sir? Did you wake up feeling lucky?
Yes, I did. I have a brother-in-law with me who has MS, and this is why I was so interested. And I said, and I've invited him to share my TA65, but, you know, he's unemployed and I'm on a fixed income, so it's been a problem. But anyway, it's not luck. I call it providence.
I love it. I love that so much. So do you take TA65 on your own?
I do. Okay. I've been taking it for over a year now. Uh-huh. And, yeah, I made 77. I had my 77th birthday and on no medication.
Wow. So you feel? Do you feel as though the TA65 has helped you in some ways?
Yes, it has, definitely. In many ways, in all ways.
Really? Well, good. I think so. Your body's not aching. You're it's not failing. You're sleeping well. The energy, the optimism, everything good.
Everything's high.
Good. All right. Well, we'll get that ball out, and you're going to share it with your brother-in-law, and
right.
Hopefully he can give us a good testimonial too.
Yes. So I can call Brenda back in after 4 o'clock.
Oh yeah, she's gonna get in touch with you right now.
Okay. Very good.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.